Okay, we're starting our third unit, European Imperialism. So far we've talked about the French Revolution, the quest for people to gain freedom and democracy and equality, and to have a stake in their own countries, to feel pride in their own nation. And that was the movement of nationalism. And as that was all going on, we also talked about the second unit, the Industrial Revolution, how there was new wealth, much more wealth, new ways of making money, new ways of earning a paycheck, new jobs, new ways of producing goods. And through the Industrial Revolution, you saw Europe. Britain actually was the center of that, but all of Europe, it spreads to all of Europe and then comes overseas to North America, especially the United States. And in the 1800s to 19th century, you start to see Europe and their life expectancy and their wealth, their power start to grow immensely. And the Europeans have a greater desire to sell these goods, to create new markets, and to gain more resources. And with this technology, they're able to go into new areas around the world. And our unit is going to be focusing on Europe, going into China, going into India, going into the Middle East, and going into Africa. And as they go into these places, they're going to basically, whether it's politically, socially, or economically, and maybe all three of those ways, control those regions so Europe can become more powerful and more wealthy. Well, today, in this podcast, we're going to be looking at Africa. How did the Europeans impact the ethnic groups of Africa? And we're going to be focusing on a couple terms, and we'll be looking at something that many people in Europe do not learn this stuff in great detail in schools, and it's something we don't even really look at too much in the United States. It's one of those units that I think is really important because it definitely impacts today. We just talked about Gaddafi, how he was killed, and how many of the people in Libya are looking to Italy for help. Well, why is that? Because Italy once controlled Libya. And there's so many ways that it impacts us today. And so here we go. Let's talk about this. The first way Europeans impact the ethnic groups of Africa, in which I want to talk about, is something called the Berlin Conference. Now, we know there's a lot of European countries, and they're gaining wealth and they're gaining power. And these Europeans want to go into Africa. It's a rush. It is a rush to get into Africa in the 1880s. And they don't want to start fighting each other, because all this land right in here is territory that was not conquered. It's up for first come, first serve, basically. It's not colonized. And the European nations realize they could easily start fighting over this stuff. So they get together in Berlin, and they decide to, kind of like a pizza, you cut up a pizza. France, you get those slices over here. Italy, you get the slices over here. Germany, you get over here. British, you get over here. Belgium's, you get right in the Congo. So they do this in order to divide up Africa and deciding which European countries would get which land in Africa. It was also to keep the Europeans from fighting each other. And the key thing you need to know is the boundaries that the Europeans make in Africa are not the boundaries that the Africans made. The Africans are not invited to the Berlin Conference. They have no say about the territory. So you start to see tribes being split up into the same countries, and now they're going to have to start fighting each other. In today's terms, Europeans pinned one tribe against another tribe. So it's pretty complicated stuff, but it's pretty important stuff when you're looking at Africa today and the problems that they're facing. If you look at the countries that make up Africa today, those boundaries were largely created by Europeans. And the Europeans left in the 1960s, 70s, a little before, a little after, and they're really trying to work this stuff out now. Back to the unit on European imperialism. So that was the Berlin Conference. Another impact I want to talk about and spend some time is a very negative impact. The Belgian Congo, this region right in here, was one of the darkest parts of African imperialism by Europe. It starts with this guy. His name is King Leopold, to be technical, the second. He's from Belgium, and he is pretty ruthless. He's probably one of the most vile men that we'll be talking about, besides the obvious makers of Hitler and Stalin. But he's extremely racist, and he's extremely greedy. I'm sorry to use these terms, but you can't dispute it. In fact, he's so bad he was even booed at his own funeral. He is known for mass murder. He comes in, the Belgians come in, and they basically create slave labor where 50% of the population end up dying. King Leopold was ruthless, and you can see that in these two pictures here. Let's look at this one. This is a political cartoon, and it says robber right here. That's what he went in. He went into Belgium, into the Congo. King Leopold sent in his men and took the resources of rubber. And rubber was, as you know, something that's important, a resource. So he was getting a lot of wealth and a lot of money from this. At the expense of who? Well, look at it. At the expense of the people living in the Congo. And here this represents a snake. It's symbolized as a snake. It's rubber right here. And these King Leopold's right here. And he is controlling the Belgian people. 50% were killed. Many of them were killed from being shot. Many of them were killed through gangrene, getting gangrene. And you can see here with these children, men, women, and children, their hands are missing. Various reasons why people's hands would have been missing in the Belgian Congo. One, cut off. Two, they would have got gangrene because as they would put rope around the people, tie rope as they would hold them off as prisoners. They would go into a village and take all the people and make them into doing forced labor. And so the ropes would get so tight that they'd get gangrene, and so they'd have to cut the hands off. It was completely ruthless. This is an account from, let me read this for a second, it's from the book King Leopold's Ghost. And it's page 166. This is someone describing what it was like in the Belgian Congo. And here's the quote. "All the blacks saw this man as the devil of the equator." That's one of the Belgian leaders in there to have one village go in and terrorize other villages, or one tribe to go after another tribe. "From all the bodies killed in the field, you had to cut off the hands. He wanted to see the number of hands cut off by each soldier, who had to bring them in a basket, or in baskets. A village which refused to provide rubber." So if these people refused to work, see in the picture here, they would be completely swept clean. So it would be a genocide. They would just kill them all. "As a young man, I saw a soldier guarding the village of Boika," I guess I'm saying it right, "take a big net, put 10 arrested natives in it, attach big stones to the net, and make it tumble into the river. Rubber caused these torments. That's why we no longer want to hear its name spoken. Soldiers made young men kill or rape their own mothers and sisters." Here's another one. "For each cartridge issued to their soldiers, they demanded proof that the bullet had been used to kill someone, not wasted in hunting, or worse yet, saved for possibility to mutiny. The standard proof was the right hand from the corpse." So every time a Belgian soldier shot a gun, wasted a bullet, and I used the he would have to have evidence of using that bullet to kill someone, and the evidence they used was to cut off the hands. This is very dark. Slave labor, 50% of the population wiped out. Joseph Conrad wrote a book called The Heart of Darkness. You'll be reading, I think, in 10th grade or 11th grade. Basically, Joseph Conrad talks about his voyage into the Belgian Congo. And interesting enough, he calls one of the men, when he went into the Congo, he saw one of the Belgian officers pretty much lose his mind. And this officer was known for displaying a row of several African heads around his garden. Joseph Conrad called that soldier or that officer who did that, the several African heads, he called him Mr. Kurtz. So I don't like that. I take offense to that. But there it is. Mr. Kurtz lost his mind and scattered several heads around. Long story, worth sharing. Okay, that's the Belgian Congo. Here's an example of Africans fighting back. Shaka was a man, a general who, a leader of the tribe of the Zulus. He really united southern Africa. It was probably the most powerful tribe in Africa, and they were called the Zulus. Shaka led them into a unification and strength. When Shaka died, the Zulus stayed around. When the British came in, basically the British won and wiped out the Zulus. Lifelong lesson, a gun will always win over a spear. That said, though, the Zulus did almost win a couple battles because they knew the terrain. And I'm sure they outnumbered the British. But the British come in and fight, and the Zulus fight back, but they lose. Another example of what was going on was the Boer War in southern Africa. Right down here, you had the Boers, which were Dutch settlers, fighting over land down here with the British. The Boers were, I believe, there first, but I want to bring up the Boer War because in southern Africa, here is an example of Europeans fighting. The Boers were the Dutch and the British, and that would, to some extent, go against the Berlin Conference. So I want to bring up that Boer War. The British do win. It's a very bloody war. Tens of thousands of Boers were put in the concentration camps, labor camps, basically like labor camps, because the Boers would use guerrilla warfare, and the Dutch didn't know the British didn't know who the enemy was, so they'd just lock them all up. Here's another example. You have Menelik II of Ethiopia. This guy is known for defeating the Italians. He's the only one that actually was able to resist the Europeans in imperializing Africa. He got weapons from the French and the British, so he was able to get guns. And with these guns, he was able to defeat the Italians. So the Italians actually lost and weren't able to get Ethiopia. Couple quick more things. Paternalism is something you need to know. Paternalism is when the Africans treated the Europeans treated the Africans much like children, like a parent, and they would take care of them, but they wouldn't give them many rights. And you did see over time the Africans start to assimilate, that is, adopt their the European culture. They'd start to speak their language, their customs, their religion, and assimilation did occur. So you did see some of these Africans become more like Europeans. Some positives, I talked about the negatives. You obviously know the negatives. You got the Belgian Congo, you got slave labor, you got boundaries being carved out by the Europeans. They have no say over the countries that they live in. And now you're going to start to see these tribes start fighting over this land because they're fighting over this country, those countries that the Europeans created. So that's clear negatives there. Some positives, though, literacy rate goes up. I mean, the Europeans come in and they teach them how to read. So literacy does end up coming in Africa. Okay? And another thing is their life expectancy grows because the Europeans come in and give them new technology on dealing with diseases and things like that. So that's a quick overview of European imperialism in Africa.